Beautiful Monday afternoon. How great it is to live in Alaska. Thank you so much. The family would really like to thank everyone for coming to the celebration of life for Richard Dick Lobdell. So we'll start with the opening prayer with Patrick O'Toole.
You can tell I'm not in the broadcasting business. As I reflected on the life of Dick Lobdell and was trying to decide the appropriate scripture to read and share today, my mind went back to many years ago as I was growing up as a kid at Mulcahy Stadium. And I would watch my dad and Dick banter back and forth and telling their jokes one after another and telling their funny stories and trying to outdo the other one to see who could laugh more and make the other one laugh more. And as I thought about their nonstop laughter, God kind of nudged me towards a passage in the Old Testament book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 3, verses 1 through 4. And in that passage, it talks about that there is a time for everything. It says there's a time and there is a season for everything. A time for every activity under heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to harvest. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to tear down and a time to build up. A time to cry and a time to laugh, a time to grieve, and a time to dance. In this passage, it tells us that there is a time to cry, and there is a time to grieve, and yes, today, this service and this celebration is meant to provide a time to mourn and to grieve. In fact, in Romans 12:15, we're asked to rejoice with those who rejoice and to weep with those who weep. And so today our hearts do weep, and we join with you, Cecilia, and your family, as you mourn your beloved husband and father and brother. But today is also a time to celebrate Dick's life. And I believe, maybe most importantly, if Dick were here today, he would say, it's certainly a time to laugh a little. In the Bible, several scriptures refer to the fact that God is the author of all joy. In Proverbs 17:22, it tells us that a joyful heart is good medicine. Laughter and the joy that it brings is an amazing thing. It's kind of a tension dissolver, and it's also kind of an antidote for anxiety. It's like a tranquilizer, which without any of the side effects, and it's absolutely free. You don't need a prescription. Laughter is also one of life's great shock absorbers. And when we lose a dear friend or family member, we certainly need a shock absorber in our lives. One of my favorite old Jewish proverbs says, what soap is to the body, laughter is to the soul. And in Psalms 126:2, there's a scripture that talks about having our mouths full of laughter and a tongue full of joyful shouting. And my friends, if you knew Dick like I knew, you know if there ever was a man who lived his life with a mouth full of laughter and a tongue full of joyful shouting, it was Dick Lobdell. And so he knew that laughter was kind of the shortest distance between two people. And so today, we certainly want to laugh as we celebrate and mourn and weep as well. And I hope that everyone here today knows that it's okay to laugh in church. That's okay. God is good with your laughter. In fact, God created our bodies to laugh. And as it says in Ecclesiastes 3:4 that I just read, there is a time to laugh, and it is a good thing. Let us pray. Dear Father in heaven, we come to you today with heavy hearts and reflective souls, and we seek your presence now as we remember and celebrate the gift of Richard and the joy that his life brought our lives as he entertained and lived and loved us. We pray your Holy Spirit will help each one here to calm their minds and open each heart to receive your message for us during this celebration time. May your Holy Spirit bring comfort and encouragement, and most of all, healing, as only you, our great physician, can. We ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Longtime Anchorage resident Richard Dick Lobdell passed away at Providence, Alaska Medical Center on Saturday, February 15, 2014. Born in Grand Rapids, Michigan, on the 27th of June in 1937, he has lived in Alaska since the age of six. Richard's passion for sports was evident at a young age, and at 12, he decided that he wanted to be a sports broadcaster. He played many sports throughout high school, continuing with softball and hockey in the Anchorage Adult Leagues. Upon graduating from Fresno State, Richard returned to Alaska to work as a cameraman, an engineer, and an announcer for Channel 11 in 1959. And in February in 1960, he reported for basic military training at Lackland Air Force Base in Texas. In October 1965, he received an honorable discharge from the United States Air Force Reserves. With a wickedly keen sense of humor, he entertained the listening audience with timely political comments, other news, and he entertained us all with his tall tales. He was known as Little Rockin' Richard, Big Country Richard, and the world's oldest living radio communicator. His years of calling play-by-play included the sports of baseball, basketball, football, softball, hockey, curling, and of course the World Championship sled dog races. He broadcast everything from Little League to high school to adult to college to semi-pro sports. He did it all on numerous radio and TV stations around Alaska. He was the voice of the Anchorage Glacier Pilots, the Alaska Gold Panthers of Fairbanks, the UAA Seawolves, and the Anchorage Northern Knights. Richard was inducted into the Alaska Broadcasters Hall of Fame in 1994 and recognized for his many years of service to the community by the Anchorage School District in 2002. He was honored by the 22nd Alaska State Legislature upon his retirement from full-time radio broadcasting in 2002. And in 2006, he was inducted into the Anchorage Glacier Pilots Hall of Fame. A Richard Lobdell Memorial Foundation has been established, and it will be providing scholarships to students interested in broadcasting. Contributions may be made to the address listed on the back of your bulletins.
Thank you, Patrick. I met Dick Lobdell in the early 80s. I had just moved up here from Idaho and got an account exec job at, it was KYMG Radio, 100.9 FM, and it was a format that just had started on FM radio. I see Andy Lohman and Dennis Bookie here, but when it first started, they said, FM radio, country western radio will never succeed on FM. So it was that long ago. We met at the coffee pot. The station was kind of designed where the sales staff was over here, and the studio was in this separate door. And Dick would come out and have his tea, I think, every morning, and he discovered this new guy from Idaho knew like sports. He liked sports, so he invited me back into his studio, and we would sit in the mornings and just talk about sports, baseball, football, basketball. And in our conversations, he discovered I had done a few games in Idaho sports broadcasting. And he asked me, he said, well, would you like to help me do the Anchorage Glacier Pilots? And I said, wow, yeah, that would be an honor. That'd be an honor. I haven't really done too much baseball. I tell you, it was my greatest blessing is to sit next to him and watch him do Anchorage Glacier Pilot baseball. He was the Vin Scully of Alaska, of how he could tell stories, funny stories, and intertwined, and you'd never miss a pitch or a foul ball, you know, in the game. And he came up with so many different great original things with the Glacier Pilots, and I think of a few. Homebrew Alley, where some of the people that enjoyed beer would go into Homebrew Alley. And if you ever went to a Glacier Pilot game, there'd be so many people with their radios there. You know, so when you'd shout out to Homebrew Alley, they would honk their horn and everyone would cheer. Another famous saying he had was, on a foul ball, there was this big pile of dirt at Mulcahy for so many years, and the kids would run to get the foul ball, and he would call them the dirt daubers. Ruin a pair of $25 jeans for a $2 baseball is what, you know, he would say. One of my favorite ones is if there was a hard name to pronounce, the person would come to bat like Joe Pastrnakovich, and he would say on the radio, for you newspaper writers listening to the broadcast, Joe Pastrnakovich spells his name J-O-E. He had in sports and baseball, you want to have a perfect saying for your home run call. And Dick was, this one's long gone. And he would say it so nicely and long. This one's long gone. That was the classic Dick Lobdell home run call. And he was telling me one time, he was, after a game, he was going and putting away the Glacier Pilot equipment. And this guy, it was at summertime, and he was a tourist, came up to him and says, how long have you been a Detroit Tiger fan? And Dick looked at the guy and said, Detroit Tiger fan? I'm an L.A. Dodger fan, you know. Detroit Tiger. Dick didn't know this guy. He says, why do you ask me that? And he said, well, Ernie Harwell, the voice of the Detroit Tigers, that's his home run call. This one's long gone. And Dick thought, oh, geez. he thought he had just a real original one. There was a couple of things that really set him off during a broadcast, and it was so funny to watch since you're sitting next to him. And way back in the early days, they would allow photographers to go on the field at Mulcahy Stadium for some reason. I don't know if the cameras couldn't shoot like they can now, but they would allow photographers to go on the field. So a photographer would go out to the third base box and stand out there. Oh, that would set him off. There's a photographer on the field. There's a photographer on the field. How can they allow that person to be out there? There's a photographer on the field. And then he really got a kick out of people would take their motorhome and park behind the outfield fence, and then they would get their lawn chairs and stand and sit on top of their motorhome. And that one drove him crazy. He would think, okay, you have a $50,000 motorhome, but you're too cheap to buy a $3 ticket to come into the ballpark. Huh? I was so lucky. Dick got me into broadcasting, and he would get calls from all these different radio stations from across the state, Fairbanks and Juneau and Kodiak and Kenai, and they would want their games broadcast back to, you know, their hometowns. And at this time, Dick was just tired of driving to Wasilla or doing games and what have you. So he gave their names to me, and he loaned the equipment for the Glacier Pilots and allowed me to drive to these different places and do the game. And that basically started myself on the way to sports broadcasting. And then later, with the help of Brad Lowers and Andy Lohman, we started the Alaska Sports Broadcasting Network like 19 years ago. So he was so instrumental in my life in sports broadcasting. And he had so many stories. You know, he before the Glacier Pilots, he did games in Fairbanks. And I believe the story goes that the Gold Panthers went to Wichita, the national championship, and they couldn't afford to send Dick. So Dick did the game as a recreation. And this is back in the old days with the old teletype machine that's telling you who's up, you know, who's batting. Dick's in a studio with a drumstick and a piece of wood. Foul ball, Joe Smith, you know. You know, home run. And then he had a person there helping him with the teletype machine and what have you like that. He told me the teletype machine ran out of paper. Talk about trouble. Well, Joe Smith fouled the ball off. Fouled the ball off. Boy, I can't believe they just can't strike out Joe Smith. Another foul ball, Joe Smith, until they can get the paper fixed in the teletype machine. You know, I think he was Dennis and Andy and Mark, I know we're all here, they'd probably know better, but I think Dick was one of the very first radio talk show hosts when talk radio was just coming about. I'm not sure if Rush Limbaugh had even started yet, but Dick Lobdell would be the voice for us every morning getting up and giving us the time and temperature and if the school was open or closed. And he would have the mayors on, and he would have the superintendent, Carol Cuomo, would be a guest. And I'd be around him when he would get compliments from people. And he also told me he really believed in, when he did that show, just to not be right wing or left wing, but just to play it right down the middle and give out as much information, you know, as he can, you know, to the listeners. And I think he would sign on every morning as the world's oldest living communicator. And this is show, and I was asking Mark, and we can't remember, but it would just be show 1,056 consecutive without missing a day. Dick just never, ever got sick. He just never, ever missed a day of work. And we used to go to lunch together a lot, Dick and I, and it would be 20 below zero, and Dick would have a windbreaker on. I mean, that was his coat, you know? So, Hall of Fame, 1994 retired, or elected into the Hall of Fame in 1994, as the obituary says, and he retired in 2002. I got to tell you, he didn't really retire in 2002. At ASPN, we had a thing called the ticker, and the ticker was really Dick Lobdell. And let me explain the ticker. Dick would be at home. He'd have a radio in the bedroom pointed towards KSRM in Kenai. He'd have another radio in the living room so he could pick up the Matsu Valley on Friday nights for football. And then poor Cecilia, he had her on the computer hooked up on the internet to get the Fairbanks scores. So he'd be keeping track of the scores all the time, and then he'd be calling them in to us as we were on the air. And we referred to it, the ticker, you know, sold out in the 20, and he'd give us all the scores. He did that for many years. Then one year he said, Kelly, I'm retiring. This is the last year I'm doing this, okay? I mean, Cecilia, you guys probably wanted to watch television. or whatever. But he let me know that this was the last year. I said, Dick, that's okay. We'll find somebody. We'll get by. So the season starts the following year. We're doing a game. Bill Lavelle's cell phone rings. Bill turns to Brad and I and says, Soldatna 20, Kenai 6. And I said, who just gave you that score? Dick. So he never really ever retired. We got, I don't know, he was the godfather of ASBN. That's what we called him. Oh, phone calls. That's the special thing that I always will remember about Dick is the phone calls. Sometimes you almost want to miss a phone call from Dick because he would leave the most funniest voicemails. He would disguise his voice as somebody else. Usually they lived in Auk Bay or Cheviac, or he'd make up the different places. And it would be, in a funny way, make a remark about last night's broadcast. And he would say, I was never Kelly Thompson. I was that Kelvin Tomlinson doesn't know a thing about football. That Bill Lavelle doesn't know anything about stats. Who in the heck has ever, that Homer Keaton guy, I don't know about him, Keaton Homer. And that Brad Lowers favors Diamond way too much. the phone calls. Yeah. There were phone call rules with Dick. And you better have followed them. Okay. You never, ever call during a UCLA football or basketball game. You know, and if you happen not to know that they were on TV, you hung up real fast. Or you would never call during an L.A. Laker game or a Los Angeles Dodger game. And then you never, ever called. Here's a free plug for Channel 2. You never called at 5 o'clock. You might get a call back from 5:30 to 6, but 6 o'clock, did not call. You got to wait to 7 o'clock. You know, you'd look, I got to call Dick. Oh, 10 after 6. He's not answering the phone. So, he would always call me. We talked on the phone a lot, and he would always call on Wednesdays. That's when we have the sports business luncheon. And I want to thank Don Winchester and Bob Shake from the sports business luncheon for help setting up the Richard Dick Lobdell Memorial Fund. So I want to thank them tremendously. And kind of a little bit in closing, I want to tell Cecilia a story. We were talking on the phone, and Cecilia comes home from Costco, and she's got a big jar of mayonnaise. You remember this, Cecilia? And he's going, what? Is that mayonnaise? Dick was a Miracle Whip man. And poor Cecilia didn't know that they had already had a big half a jar of mayonnaise in the refrigerator, and they were out of Miracle Whip. And he was giving her the hardest time. I said, Dick, would you lay off her? How in the world does she put up with you? How does she put up with you sometimes? And he goes, I love her. I love her. I love her. And I said, how did you guys meet? How did you guys meet? And he said, well, I was general manager. It was long. It was storied radio career. He was a general manager, I think, of KYAK when it was down on Dowling Road, the general manager, the chief man in charge. And they had a song contest, you know, name that song and you would win a prize. Well, the rules were you could only win once a week. But there's this woman named Cecilia constantly coming in and winning. And they would call Dick and said, "That Cecilia lady, she's in here again trying to claim a prize. Don't she just won last Tuesday?" She just won last Tuesday. So, and that, I think, is how you guys met and went on to have just a wonderful, wonderful marriage. And I think the real winner, Cecilia, was Dick, not you, for the wonderful marriage that you guys had together. And I know you asked me to do this. You asked me to do this today, and I told you I was a little hesitant, and you said, "Well, Kelly, Dick's phone calls meant so much to him, the phone calls that we had together." But I got to tell you, the phone calls from him to me were way more important than mine to him. And, you know, I will miss him. I will miss him forever. I didn't realize there was a part here. I want everyone to know we have microphones here. And they're open, and I think now is the time. Please feel free to come down and share some of your thoughts and memories of Dick Lobdell. I know Brad's up, and he's going to be the first one because he's probably got basketball practice to run to. So we'll turn it over to the crowd now, but please feel free to come down and share stories of the legend. Brad? No, I think you might have to turn it on. I mean, turn it on.
My gym voice?
There we go.
Okay. I just looked around the room. I saw there's a lot of people that could talk, so I didn't want to wait. and truthfully, practice is at 4 o'clock, too. But I was talking with Matt Nevila down here and thinking how close we are to the airport. If a plane hits here, there's not going to be a game broadcast for a long, long time. Got people, broadcasters everywhere, and what a tribute. Wouldn't you like, in whatever your profession is, to look around and see as many colleagues are here for Dick Lobdell today? That's really a tribute. About 20-some years ago, I was wandering around West High School, and somebody asked me if I wanted to do a basketball game on the radio, and I thought that'd be pretty cool. So I got to go up with Dick Lobdell. We were in the upper seats at West High, and he taught me so much. I can't even remember all he taught me, and I'll share something that's pretty trivial, but maybe some of you broadcasters will understand. But I went up there the first time, and at that time, you know, I don't know, I had a couple sodas. I threw them down. I got up there. I'm on the air, and it's almost halftime, and I am dying. And he said, "You don't drink sodas before you do a game, especially at West High School." So that's something I've never forgot. It sounds like it's not that important, but hey, it's pretty important. But just remembering games and different things with him over the years. What he was great at, of course, was with nicknames. You know, Jim Mason became the Big Whistle, and that became his nickname. And Bill Lavelle, would anybody know Bill Lavelle without the human computer? That's part of his card. You got to read it. And that's where that nickname came from. I kind of laugh now. I think people, Kelly, who do games, who they have no idea where it came from, but they know they're required to say the human computer, because Dick established that. One of my greatest opportunities to broadcast games with Dick Lobdell was one year. I was called in to the office, and they said, "We don't know how we're going to coach our basketball team without you next year, but starting tomorrow, we're going to try." So that gave me a year off to do games on the radio, and I did UAA games, and we went down on one road trip. I got to pick out a road trip, went to Rupp Arena, which was just pretty cool. And there was a 7-foot-2 guy doing the game for Kentucky. It was Sam Bowie, and I thought, boy, this would be neat to interview him. And I interviewed him at halftime, and that was just a real highlight of my life. And I think about that, and I think, now why did I get to interview Sam Bowie? And I'll tell you the reason why. It's because Dick Lobdell let me. Because he let me. Because he wanted me to have that experience. And that's just the kind of generous spirit that he has and that Kelly has, and that one day I hope to have. Because I don't give up games, but Kelly will give up a game to somebody, and Dick will give up a game to somebody, and I'll never forget that. And we had that trip, and then, you know, in the later years when Dick was keeping track of all those games, he was the ticker. Billy got to answer the phone most of the time, but once in a while I got to answer it. And, you know, we're going to miss him, and I just think about it, and just what a great career he has. And I just think you cannot think of sports in Alaska on the air in the last 30, 40 years. You take out Dick Lobdell, and that is such a small little thing happening there. And he's been a giant, and he's influenced those of us who go on. And what a privilege to be here to remember him today and all the good things about him. Thank you.
Me too, Brad. My first radio experience was with Dick Lobdell. I, as a teenager, worked for what was then KENI Radio and TV, and I was primarily in the engineering end of things. I worked primarily in television, but Dick grabbed me one day and said, "Hey, I need some help at a basketball game. You want to come and help me out?" And so, sure, I'd love to. And so I go help him out, and essentially what I did is keep score, and he had me do the stats between, and occasionally he'd go down to get something to eat, and he'd be late getting back, and I'd have to kind of wing it until he got there. And he always appreciated that I would be willing to wing it, but the best wing it was one summer he was the supervisor of the announcers, and he needed somebody to cover about a three-week shift, which was the midnight shift from midnight to six. And he knew that I'd had a lot of experience at operating the board and had done live engineering work before in the studio. So he knew I knew what to do. It's just, you know, could I talk? And so he talked me into doing the radio show. He called me Mad Michael. And so he says, so meet me there at 11:30 and you'll do the midnight news. And then it's yours till 6, and I'll be in at 6 and take over. And so, okay. So I show up at 11:30, and kid working the board there, the guy that was on in front of me, says, "Hey, man, you got to get the news together. You're up for the news." So I go back to the teletype and start tearing off the news, get a newscast together, and walk out there about 5 to 12, and the guy's got a record playing, and he's gone. And like, huh. And no Richard. And so, man, I'm starting to get a little bit nervous. This is getting tense. And he says, so I sit down there, and it's, you know, it's pretty easy to read the news. And so I open up the mic, I read the newscast, and got done with the news, closed the mic, and did a couple of promos. And, man, where's Richard? And so, well, here I am. So cue up a record, and 45s, by the way, cue up a record and get ready to go on the record. And I open up the mic to say something, and nothing would come out. And so I close the mic and start the record. And, oh, man, I got to come up with something here. So when the record got over with, I was able to say who it was on the record and introduce the next one, close the mic, and away it goes. And after about 20 minutes, in strolls Rockin' Richard. Like, "Rockin' Richard, where you been, man? You said you're going to meet me here and help me out, get going on this." He says, "Well, I've been here." I says, "Well, I haven't seen you." "Well, no, I've been out in my car listening to you, man." "And you did good. That's what I did. I helped you do this, and I didn't have to come in here and interview. So keep it up, and I'll see you at 6. Away he goes. One day he was hearing me talking in the TV studio about my batting average going up pretty good and playing Legion, and he says, "You know, I bet you can't hit my softball." I said, "What are you talking about, man? Softball's twice as big as a hardball. I can touch it all I want." And I got moved to to lead off batter because I was touching the ball so much, and that's what I was bragging about. And I was touching on 350, and he says, well, I bet you can't hit this softball. And I said, Richard, I could hit it all day. He says, well, that sounds like a body bet to me, buddy. You better show up down there at 9th Avenue here. We get done with the newscast. He was a sports director then. We'll go down there and see if you can touch my softball. So I show up there, and he has his catcher there waiting for us. And I had a couple buddies with me. And so I get up there and say, hey, I'm going to hit you left-handed, man. So I stepped over to the left-hand side, man. He flings this softball down there, 60-mile-an-hour fastball, about this big around. I whiffed it big time. Like, hey, I'm going to try it right-handed. He's like, okay, all right. So 6 pitches later, I hit a foul ball. 12 pitches later, I got a legitimate hit. But the only reason I got a legitimate hit is because Richard was out there giggling so much, watching me go after his unbelievable softball pitch. So not only did he do a lot in the broadcast world. Hey, by the way, you did miss one little aspect in the obit. He was one of the main guys to do radio broadcast in what's probably some of the earliest snow machine races ever on the planet. He was the anchor man for the Midnight Sun 600, which was a snow machine race that left Anchorage and went to Fairbanks on the road, and went through Delta. And so he hooked me up with doing that. A buddy of mine and I took a car up, and we drove up the highway and followed the race. And when we got to Gulcana, it was 58 below. And from that time on until we got back to Anchorage, we never turned off the car. The car stayed on for like 10, 12 days the entire time because it was 70 below in Delta. And Lord knows what it was in Fairbanks. It was similar to that. But he put me up in Hatcher Pass one time on the Palmer to Willow race. And I stayed there doing the broadcast until my radio got covered by snow and it went out. We carried a battery up there on a snow machine. But he was a real improviser and creative in making this happen and be a real wonderful broadcast. And so I'll never forget him. I had some wonderful times as a young man. He was 10 years older than me or 11 years older than me, but he treated me with a lot of respect. And he obviously gave me a start. I'm sure he detected a willingness to have a gift for gab, that I didn't belong in engineering as bad as I thought I did. I ought to try a little of this talk and stuff, and I did. And I'll never quit thanking him for that. It was a wonderful experience working with him even late in his career as well.
You'd think I was in radio or something. Well, hi, everybody. You might not know who I am. My name is Bob Barger, or Dick would call me Bob Berger, along with Kellen Tomlinson, Homer Keaton, Bill LaValle, but he always got Brad Lauer's name correct. I met Dick when I was 16 years old. I started sports announcing down in Southeast Alaska in Sitka when I was 15, and met Dick. He was visiting Juneau at the time, the old Midnight Sun Broadcasting Corporation, at KINY in Juneau. And I went over from Sitka to Juneau to broadcast, and my headset broke. I went over there, and I knew Warren and Ken Wiley, who ran KINY, and Dick was down visiting. And Dick at the time was working at KENI here in Anchorage. And Dick, his humor right off the bat, the old KINY studios was on South Franklin Street down by what is now the tour float or the tour dock there in Juneau. And it was a Saturday about 9 o'clock in the morning, and went in there, and Dick I introduce myself, and Dick goes, well, how many drunks did you have to climb over to get into the studio here? Because, yeah, everybody, you know, that was where all the winos hung out and stuff. And I saw there was nobody there and stuff. He goes, well, you're lucky. So Dick and I hit it off. And later on in the 70s and the 80s, I would come to Anchorage to cover sporting events, and always made it a point to see Dick. And Dick says, hey, why don't you come and sit in and work some games with me? And I had that opportunity to work many, many sporting events, whether it be baseball or basketball with Dick. And it was always just a great time, and I always learned things. And one of the favorite stories I had, Dick asked me, well, what got you interested in sports? Sports announcing. Well, my brother had a reel-to-reel tape recorder when I was like 9 years old, and I would get my baseball card collection, or my Uncle Bill got me a subscription to the Sporting News newspaper, and back then it was real thick, and I would cut pictures out and simulate baseball games in my bedroom and with a die. One was a single, two was a double, three was a triple, four home run, five ground out, and six a fly out. And I would broadcast that into the reel-to-reel and play it back. And Dick says, you know, that's a good story, because when I was a kid, I would go out in the alleyway behind my house here in Anchorage with a broomstick or a baseball bat, broken bat if you got it at the ballpark, and bat rocks. And in his mind, he would broadcast the baseball games. And the creativity that Dick had was just phenomenal. So we had a lot of that in common. Another humorous story I have, and Kelly at the earlier in the program here brought that up, but we would get the Anchorage Northern Knights broadcast when they played in the old CBA here, and Dick was the broadcaster. And there was a fellow from Auburn University. His name was Stan Patkavich. Don't ask me how to spell that name, but Dick says, well, for you folks, I'll spell the name for you. That's Patkavich, S-T-A-N, Stan Patkavich. So it was great. And then another story that I had with Dick was had an opportunity to work with some longtime announcers, Steve Agbaba and Wee Willie Wally, Bill Wally, who used to live in Fairbanks, did a lot of games with the Gold Panthers, worked with some games with Bill in Juneau, and Bill also swung through Anchorage a few times and did some sports, things like that. And there was a time Bill was doing broadcasting for the Fairbanks Gold Panthers, and Dick was on and off helping Bill. And Red Boucher was the head guy of the Gold Panthers at the time. And Red was always wanting to get promotions, always wanting to do something new. And he says, you know, I'm the third base coach over here. Why don't you mic me up? Well, back in those days, there was no such thing as a wireless microphone. So Bill goes, well, I'll see what I can do. So he went to the KFAR studios in Fairbanks, and he found about 250 feet of microphone cord, and he stretched it from the press box at Groudon Memorial Park in Fairbanks down to the third base coaching box. And so he got the lapel mic, and what he did is he put a lanyard, neck lanyard around, hooked it up to the microphone on Red. And it was going along in the game. Bill had the mic mixer up, and they were talking, conversing back and forth. Red had the transistor radio in his ear so he could hear what was going on in the conversation. Well, it got to the bottom of the ninth, and the Gold Panthers were behind 3-2 to this team from the lower 48. Runners at first and second, two outs. And a guy for the Gold Panthers hit the ball just inside the first baseline, down in for extra bases. Well, the guy from second scored easily, just tie the game. Well, the guy who was one of the slowest guys, from what I understand, was at first base. So he had to come in to win the game. Well, Red's bringing him around. So the guy touches second. Come on. Touches third. So Red wants to take off and run along with this guy. And, well, there's only so much microphone cord. And it clotheslined Red. Well, Bill Wally said, you know, I couldn't get my hand over fast enough to the language that went out on KFAR airwaves that day. Well, that was one of Dick's favorite stories for me to tell him. And to put the top on my segment here, Kelly, another thing Kelly shared with you, is he always disguised his voice. And just a couple years ago, Steve Sheely, my broadcast partner with the Glacier Pilots, and I were up there at Mulcahy Stadium. And there was a kid from Texas Christian University. His name was Jason Coates. And the kid is in the Major League Farm System. Now, the kid could hit a ball a country mile. And he hit the ball that one night, went over the light tower in left center field, and landed about the 30-yard line in Anchorage Football Stadium. And I said, man, he hit that ball clear to lower Cook Inlet. Well, it was the next inning. Steve was doing play-by-play, and my cell phone rang. And it was Dick that called. And he disguised his voice, and he goes, this is Leonard Cabin Boy from Akbay, Alaska. Just did the great impersonation of an Alaskan native fellow. He goes, I just want to let you know I'm fishing down here by Seldovia, and I caught that ball that fella hit. So, I'll tell you what. Dick Lobdell, I tip my cap to you, sir, because in my opinion, you are the greatest sports broadcaster there have ever been in the state of Alaska, and always will be. God bless you, Dick Lobdell.
Good afternoon. My name's Matt Nevela. Some of you obviously know that I spent the better part of a decade as part of the Daily News Sports Department. Showed up here in late 95 as a know-nothing 24-year-old. I actually had met my wife and kind of followed her back up here, so I really didn't know anybody. I barely even knew her when I got here. So I kind of started feeling it out, getting to know the people you got to know in town, and you know, this kind of started and sort of ended with Dick Lobdell. So I got to know him through kind of being at various high school events and all that, and then as I got into some other things, I started volunteering with him a little bit at ASAA events, where I kind of took over from him a little bit in terms of the media relations with things like the state basketball tournament, which usually just meant meeting Dick down in the what I call the dungeon of Sullivan Arena, where the media would sit back in the days prior to wireless internet and all that sort of thing, and make sure they had copies of scorebooks and all these sort of things. But you know, like I said, you kind of get here and you don't know anybody, or you're kind of feeling your way into a new city, a new community. And I can remember distinctly when I felt that I had made it as part of the Alaska media family, if you will. And I want to say this was probably late 90s, early 2000, when Dick was still happened to be calling this Pilots game. So maybe it was the late 90s. And those in the business are familiar with the live read, you know, which is essentially a commercial you're giving. And instead of going to commercial, you're reading it over, you know, in between a pitch or what have you. So I'm in the booth next to him, or maybe I was wandering behind him. And I'm going to, this borderline works blue, so everyone be prepared. It was, when Matt Nevela has family and friends in town, you'll find them at the Great Alaska Bush Company, proud sponsors of your Anchorage Glacier Pilots. I really took that one to heart. I just knew it meant something. It meant, hey, you're part of the crew. You're my friend. You're part of the team. And I'll never forget that. I'll never forget, as time wore on, we kind of would be overly serious with each other, where his phone call or his, you know, whatever I'd see him would be Mr. Nevela, and I'd be Mr. Lobdell, and very stressed, like, you know, we're dignitaries at the United Nations or something like that, when really all we were doing was talking about when the next game started. But as I thought about it a little bit more, me saying Mr. Lobdell truly meant that I respected and loved the man, because I figured out he's history. He's the legend that I'm rubbing elbows here 3,000 miles away from my Michigan home or the communities that I grew up in. And So I'll never forget that. And one of the nicknames that I really liked, and I liked seeing it in some of the things, was that he was the Sheriff of Spinard. Well, I'm fortunate enough to be with my wife and my two daughters. We don't live too far from here. Actually, I walked here from home today, so I'm basically in the sheriff's territory, and I'm really glad to say that he'll be looking over me and my family from now on. Thanks a lot.
My name's Mike Scanlon, and I knew Dick. I grew up in Fairbanks, and I did color for the Monroe High School basketball in the mid-70s, you know, big country kayak, and, you know, anybody could tell good stories of Dick, but I kind of knew he was a good person. I did color. You can see I couldn't do play-by-play, but every game we would have to, my broadcast partner, who was Rick O'Brien, and every game we would have to pick, this is back in the days when you, I suppose you could get away with it, but you named a player of the game who was Mr. Pizza, and he got this big pizza from one of the pizza places. And there was a player, he was playing center at the time. Since then, he likes to go outside and shoot threes. But his name was Ted Stepovich, and he probably had five or six games in a row. He just had a real run of scoring, and he just played well. So every game, here's Mr. Pizza. And Dick said something about, maybe you ought to get somebody different the next game. And we decided to give it, the bench came in and did a good job, and we decided to give it to the entire bench, and Dick fired us. And we didn't know it at the time, but his father had just died, and just in a couple days later, he called up and apologized, and I'll never forget that, you know, and hired us back. But when I moved to Anchorage in the mid-80s, you know, you could tell any number of stories about the Glacier pilots, but I can't remember the guy's name, but he was obviously his partner. I think it was Dave, somebody. He would make a joke. There'd be out in the right field bleachers, there'd be one person out there, or the left field bleachers. And he'd say, there's the Dave, might have been Farmer, might have been somebody's, there's the Dave Farmer fan club out there. And I just never carried it out, but I just thinking, you know, I ought to get a little cardboard thing and go Dick Lobdell fan club and sit in the same place. But never did.
My name is Sandy Baker, and being a lifelong Alaskan, of course, I'd always heard of Dick Lobdell, but I hadn't personally met him. And in 1993, I think it was, Cash Radio bought the Fox, and they were working on buying KENI, and at the time they were over in the lagoon still, and I got a phone call asking if I would go help out, and I was going to work for Cash, but I was going to be in the building with KENI and a Fox. Wasn't overly welcomed into the building, and didn't really have any friendly voices in there. And I met Dick, and I'm trying really hard to become friends with anybody who'll be kind to me in the building. And in the course of conversation, it came up that my foster brother is Pat O'Toole. And you don't grow up in the neighborhood I grew up in and not be a Glacier Pilot fan. Hello, Glacier Pilot Blue. And because Dick, of course, was Glacier Pilot, that built a kinship for us. And not a day went by that I went into work that Dick didn't come to my little kind of closet cubby area that I had and said hello to me and made sure that I felt welcome and that all was good. As the years went by, I always just referred to Dick as he's my friend, and that's just kind of one of the best compliments you can have. He really was my friend, just a good, kind, nice man, and I appreciated him as my friend.
I'm Wayne Bowden. Hello, test. I'm Wayne Bowden, and I first met Dick when he came to Anchorage. I've been here since 39. And in 1951, I bought a little Crosley station wagon for my first car, and I'm currently restoring it. And Dick called me one day, and he said, I need help. I got a football team. I need to get up the Romy Hill to practice. So I took the Crosley over, and I folded the back seat forward and literally stacked them into the back of the car, and Dick rode up with me. I didn't have a problem until I got to Romy Hill. And then I had to downshift it to first gear, and it's a 26.5-horsepower engine, and it just crept up that hill. But I got them up to the field okay. Now we have to fast forward into the late 90s. My first career was with Hewitt's Drugstore and my father for 25 years, and then in 75, I went to work for the Department of Labor in the unemployment unit and also in job service. Well, as we got into the job service end of it, in the late 90s, my supervisor had me call the radio stations for listing the jobs on that we had every week. And I guess from 98 to June of 99, when I retired, I would call and talk to Dick. So we've had pretty neat connections all the way through. I had a lot of fun visiting with him. On June 30th, my last day, I got to talk with him a little bit longer. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Don Winchester. About 10, 15 years ago, I got a call from the university, and they needed a color person to do the basketball games. And you know, I'm not in broadcasting, have no desire to be in broadcasting, but Tim McDivitt is from the university is the person that called, and he's given me the pitch, and I'm just not excited. Then he said, you know, you'll be working with Dick Lobdell. And I thought, oh, okay, yeah, you know, I can do that because, you know, anybody could probably work with Dick Lobdell and be good. So, yeah, I said, yeah, I'd do that. And as it turned out, you know, I was terrible. Probably as bad as Bill Walton. And Kelly, we know that Dick Lobdell, even though Bill Walton was a UCLA person, he hates Bill Walton as an announcer, correct?
Yes, yeah, yeah. Yes.
So, but I was honored, and I was so glad that I did that because, you know, you unless you sit there right with it, it is very difficult to broadcast games, and Dick did that so well and so easy. I can remember him even saying, Don, you do the stats. And, you know, I wasn't very good. I'm saying hi to people walking by. You know, I've got the popcorn, and when it comes time to do the stats, I would probably say something like that, they don't look good. And Dick would just go right in. He just never missed a beat. It was just incredible, his professionalism. And I, too, was honored to be able to work with him. One other story is here 2 or 3 years ago, happened to be in front of the school board on an issue. It was 11:30 on a Monday night, and up testifying, and I've kind of over the years done a little bit of research on some of the sports, and as you know, nobody knows the stuff better than Dick. But Don Smith, and I don't know if Don is here, was on the school board at the time, and they were talking before I got up there about maybe when the first football game was in Alaska. And they didn't have it quite right. So when I got up to testify, I did say, look, the first football game was in 1951. Anchorage played Ketchikan. Anchorage beat Ketchikan 21-7. So my talking, my phone is buzzing. And of course, you can't answer. When I got back to my seat, it was Dick, and he put in there, Anchorage won 35-0. So I'm thinking, man, that is incredible. Next day, of course, first of all, I'm thinking, who watches a school board meeting at 11:30 on Monday night? There's maybe three people, and Dick Lobdell was one of them. And I guess that goes along with his radio shows. You know, Dick cared about this community and was very connected to this community. So not just the sports, but he watched or listened to everything that was going on and knew what was going on. That's why his talk show was the number one talk show, and he did a great job. He just flat knew what was going on. But anyway, to finish, I did go back and check in the thing, and Dick was right. I mean, I should have never even questioned Dick, but anyway, we will miss Dick, and thank you for sharing him.
Hi, Cecilia. I was Nancy Fulton when I worked for BCR. I worked at KYAK in the late 70s, and he was such a wonderful first boss to kind of get me going in the right direction. Good-hearted, patient, great sense of humor, and taught me a lot, really a lot. And I can still see the look on his face when I went in to tell him that the engine had seized up on my Vega and I needed to borrow $300, which he gave to me. And so I'm still here, and he means an awful lot to an awful lot of us.
My name's Pete Armstrong. As you might hear, I'm not an American, I'm a foreigner. And I started working with Dick in 89. And I come from the other side of broadcast. I come from the sales side. And I'll be honest with you, you know, I've been in the Green Berets, I've been to sea for quite a few years, and I joined KENI and Dick's scared the life out of me. He really did. You know, you had to kind of wait outside the door, knock on the door a couple of times, and there was this little square window that was about this big. And even if he wasn't broadcasting, he'd pretend to be doing something, so you had to wait outside for, you know, and then he'd kind of wave you in. And I happened to pick up one of the clients that Dick did all of the radio voice work for, Alaska Mining and Diving. And, you know, the biggest thing I'd ever written up until that point, let alone a commercial, was a postcard to my wife, you know, from various places I'd been. And so I take this stab, you know, somebody tells me, well, you know, you're supposed to write the commercials, and I take a stab at writing a commercial for Alaska Mining and Diving, and I leave it, like, you know, in the studio for Dick to come in and take it into one of the other studios and do the voice work on it. And a day goes by, nothing, and I thought, oh, it must be done, it must be in the rotation. Next day, the spot's missing. And so I go in and say to Dick, Dick, you know, what happened? And he basically tells me, you know what? It wasn't any good. I couldn't read it. It wasn't any good. So at this point, I realize we're losing money. The spot's not playing. And of course, we get it right. And long story short, over about a 12-year period of working with Dick, I finally became the guy that supplied him with all his cigars. That was how I got all my spots done. You know, I'd bring in a nice cigar and he'd give me the thumbs up and do my spot. But you know, we called him one cut Lobdell, because he'd go in the studio, he'd do one cut, and that was it. And if there was something wrong, you know, if he pronounced something wrong, he wasn't going to do it again. That spot ran for a week, you know, with it wrong, you know. So it was always funny, and I remember kind of near the end when I left the station, I had just come back from Miami, and I, you know, you can get Cuban, an offshoot of a Cuban cigar down in Miami, and I brought Dick a bunch of Cuban cigars back with me. And this is the first time in like almost 12 years. I went in and I said, you know, hey, I brought you something back from Miami, the Cuban cigars. And this is the first time he ever showed any kind of warmth, if you will. He said, you know, you're all right. That was it. I felt pretty good about that.
All right. Thank you, everyone. We're going to start the AV presentation now, okay? All right.
Did your app change? Which it is, I can't decide. Them and they burst apart with sweet memories, sweet memories of holding hands and red bouquets and twilights trimmed in purple haze and laughing eyes and simple ways and quiet nights and gentle days with you. Memories press between the pages of my mind. Memories sweeten through the ages just like wine. Of holding hands and red bouquets and twilights trimmed in purple haze and laughing eyes and simple ways and quiet nights and gentle days with you. Memories press between the pages of my mind. Memories sweetened through the ages just like wine. Memories.
then you softly leave, and it's me you need to share. How deep is your love?
Deep is your love. How deep is your love? I really need to learn, 'cause we're living in a world of fools, breaking us down, when they all should let us be. We belong to you and me.
I believe in you. You know the door to my very soul. You're the light in my deepest, darkest doubt. You're my savior when I fall. And you may not think I care for you, when you know down inside that I really do. It's me you need to share. How deep is your love?
Is your love?
How deep is your love? I really mean to learn, 'cause we're living in a world of fools, breaking us down, when they all should let us be. We belong to you and
thank you.
On behalf of the family, again, we want to thank you all for coming and sharing. And I know a lot more could share a lot more stories, and we hope you'll stay and share the stories and the memories continue. We have a ton of food in the back, thanks to Max Shelton and many of you. And we want you to stay. The family wants you to stay. And we're going to, right after we dismiss from here, go to the reception area, which is right behind this stage. You can go out either of these side doors. The family also wanted me to mention that if you did not get a chance to sign the guest book, there's one in the reception area and one out here in the lobby, that you please do that, because I want to know everyone that was here today. There's also out in front these memory cards with the doves on the front. If you have a story or a message you'd like to leave for the family, just go ahead and fill that out and leave it in the basket. That would be great as well. I, too, am going to miss Dick Lobdell, and I'm going to miss those phone calls. And I knew he always had me on speakerphone, and Celia was listening the whole time. He loved ribbing me. He loved making me laugh. He loved getting my goat. I'm going to miss the times that he would call me up saying that every contest I ever run was a fix, and he was never buying a Glacier Pilot raffle ticket from me again because he didn't win. I'm going to miss him banning Max Shelton and I for life from baseball trivia because we called in from the ballpark every night and won. And I'm one of the things I'm going to miss the most is the monthly phone call I almost always got disguising his voice, saying that he was the Anchorage Police Department and he had a SWAT team outside my door. And I needed to come out immediately with my hands up and confess to whatever he felt offense I had done that week. So I'm going to miss Dick Lobdell. So will you please stand, and I will read our closing scripture, and we'll have prayer. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 54 through 58, it says, "Then, when our dying bodies have been transformed into bodies that will never die, this scripture will be fulfilled. Death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? For sin is the sting that results in death, and the law gives sin its power. But thank God, he gives us victory over sin and death through our Lord Jesus Christ. So, my dear brothers and sisters, be strong and immovable. Always work enthusiastically for the Lord, for you know that nothing you do for the Lord is ever useless." Let us pray. Our precious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time that we've had of sharing the memories and the stories and the celebration that we've had. We thank you for the vessel of your child, Richard Lobdell, and the time you allowed us here to enjoy his presence during these past 76 years on earth. We now commend his spirit and soul into your loving arms for all eternity and look forward to the day when we will be reunited. Bless now our fellowship as we continue to share and comfort and reflect with each other. In your son's name we pray. Amen.